Hi everyone, just popping up to let you know that as well as this episode on YouTube, we have another one sitting on beastofwar.com beginning to cover our journey into a 30k army creation. So this week we're having a look at the heroes. Come across and join us.
Fight for the Iron Kingdoms as a warcaster. Take control of the mighty jacks, arcane devices and dark sorceries to bring the fight to the War Machine Hub on beastofwar.com.
I'm Warren, a huge fan of tabletop games, but few games out there have a story so deep as Warhammer 40k. I'm setting out to explore this vast universe and the game with my trusty guide, AJ. So join us on Warhammer 40k Charted. Hi guys, and welcome back to 40k Charted, our Monday morning sail through the world of the 40k Imperium. I'm glad last week, by the way, that you enjoyed our little flurry into some of the, I suppose, some of the, we call them like the watercolor moments. Or somebody's going, watercolors? Watercolors? Are you Bob Ross? No, water cooler moments. In other words, the stuff we like to talk about after a game is over. And I learned a ton about Tank Shock because, as I'd said in the video, I was very one-dimensional when it came to Tank Shock. And I didn't realize that I could use it in other more kind of, not only interesting ways, but more effective ways, that, you know, where it actually would serve a purpose beyond just crushing my enemies. Anyway, for the next couple of episodes, next two or three episodes, we're going to be having a look at the Emperor. Mm-hmm. I want to get back to the fluff. We will be mixing things up with a little bit of Tactica, and then we're going to continue with the fluff. And remember, we have a live battle report planned, at least one, maybe two. And then this Christmas, we're going to be doing Mechanicus Week. And then for all you backstagers, we're also going to be doing the Cacaradon Weekend. And they should be good fun.
That should be, yeah. We're looking forward to those.
Now, on with the story. We've covered the Chaos Gods. Zinch. I'm utterly sold on Zinch. However, so much as the Chaos Gods are there as an ever-prevalent kind of backdrop to the whole thing, the 40K story is really, it's the story of the demise of humanity. This is humanity's end that we're witnessing. They're not going to win or survive this. And I've heard this from senior guys within Games Workshop. They're saying, look, what you have to understand, you know, people talking about the story moving on and stuff like that. This is the end. And what this entire story encompasses is the final moments of mankind. And to truly get a grasp on the whole of mankind and where we are, personally, I think it'll probably start and end with the Emperor.
That's a fair assumption, yeah. The thing is, I mean, we'll look at this throughout the next couple of videos, but although this is the end of the Imperium and the end of the kind of humanity en masse, humanity's gone through some pretty dark times already. We all know about the heresy. We touched on that in the Chaos videos. We know about the kind of, before the Great Crusade, there was that Age of Strife. And again, some terrible things going on there. So we're at the end of the age of the Imperium in the 41st millennium, but we don't know what lies beyond that. We don't know how it'll end. It could be the Nids, the Tyranids, coming in full force, because we don't know how much of them we have seen, whether we've seen most of them, if that threat's kind of diminished, or if that's an even larger threat beyond. So we don't even know if the Emperor will survive much longer. After all, he's the kind of guiding light of the Imperium, so we don't know how much more we have of him. But then there's other things that we're not too sure about. Some of the Primarchs, we don't know if they're going to return. There was some that just went missing. Others were held in stasis the moment of their death and appear to be slowly coming around. We don't know if that's wishful thinking on the part of the those people that follow them. But there's, you know, the likes of Gilliman, he's kind of held in stasis and seems to be slowly starting to move again. So we don't know what'll happen when we go beyond that,
like, even if Primarch returns, what could they do? You know, because none of them, as we're about to find out during this series, were even a shadow of the power that was contained within the Emperor. Over the next three videos, we're breaking them down loosely into the origins of the Emperor. I want to understand the origin stories and what that means. We'll then look at the kind of the timeline of the Imperium, the timeline of the Emperor, to get a better understanding of that narrative thread that has run through his life. And then in the last episode we're gonna discuss the end, and then we'll get into things like the Golden Throne. So in terms of the Emperor, you know, I realized whenever we talked about the Chaos Gods that as little as I knew about them, I knew even less about the Emperor. For such a defining figure in the whole of the 40K fluff, all my emphasis has been on understanding Horus and Gulliman, and you know, I've been more into the Primarchs, and then just this Emperor. The Emperor was just this fleeting, ever-present character that was there to be revered, but I don't know anything about him. What's the origin, sir? What do we know?
I suppose whenever we see him in 40K, there's almost this feeling of kind of King Duncan from Macbeth. You know, he's the character that is very kind of stalwart but quiet, and we don't know an awful lot about him because he never kind of directly exposes himself within the story. So that's why probably we don't know an awful lot about him in terms of kind of on the battlefield or in that kind of way. So whenever we look at him in the kind of early kind of creation of the Emperor, we have to look at how he was, although he's man, he is a human. In the same respect, he's beyond human, much in the same way as the Primarchs were later on, but they were kind of genetically created. What happened was, in ancient times, sort of hinted it. It's hinted at being roughly about 8,000 years BC in our kind of, if we were kind of run our timeline along the same timeline as the 41st millennium, the Imperium.
So we're taking this now loosely, because because this is all just hinted at. We're taking this now and basing this as if we are part that our timeline that we live in, with Christ, Buddha, all these the things that our timelines are the same timeline. So 8,000 years BC, which is 10,000 years ago from now. So 10,000 years ago, what?
There was a group on Earth, on Terra, who were called the Shamans. The Shamans were kind of psychers, although they didn't know they were psychers, if that makes sense. The term psyker hadn't been kind of created. I suppose in a way they were maybe sorcerers or something along those lines. Basically, they sensed the coming of the god Selenesh. They sensed the fall of the Eldar. They maybe weren't aware of the Eldar, but they kind of sensed that something was happening within the universe. And they knew that they had to create a sort of god in their own right, create a kind of...
some kind of super being.
Some super being, yeah.
Yeah.
Who was essentially the collective embodiment of all of these shamans' sort of souls.
And were the shamans individual shamans of different clans, or was it a race called the shamans, or...?
It's in a lot of the early fluff, it states that there was this kind of race. However, we don't know whether that they were maybe heads of this clan. You know, they were kind of... they certainly seemed important, so they might have been like priests, priestesses, that kind of thing. But they were kind of... the only way that they could resolve the situation to gather all of their souls into one body and to be reincarnated as one was to commit ritual mass suicide. So getting back to the Grimdark.
We're never far away from really? Okay. Yep.
So once they committed the completed the ritual, Their souls combined all of the strength into one, essentially a fetus, one baby, one child, that was then born, and that was the Emperor. That was what we know now to be the Emperor.
And was the Emperor, like, was it instantaneous, so that the Emperor was born 10,000 years ago from today? Or was it that they do all this and then some thousands of years later the Emperor was born? Do we know?
He was born naturally, as far as we're aware. And then what happened was he traveled throughout history. So he lived throughout whatever we know happened. So he probably would have been around for the Romans and all those kind of later things, you know, for our history, right up to sort of later in the 30th millennium, mm-hmm. 31st millennium, whenever kind of we...
So he was a long-lived kind of a guy.
Yeah, very much so, yeah.
There's a name, there's a character in literary, there's a character who kind of walks through life, and I can't remember what it is, but, you know, there's a book about this guy, and he basically just doesn't die, and he just... Mm. It just travels through the millennia. Mm-hmm. You can imagine actually now, if it was the 30th millennium before he really started to impose himself, mm-hmm. you know, there's 30,000-40,000 years worth of experience and everything. That's an incredible concept, mm-hmm. you know, to have. An entity like that, you know, among us.
Well, what's amazing about the Emperor is that we know through hints and different bits and pieces that throughout the fluff he was influencing, because obviously he was a very powerful being. And as he learned about what he was, he started to influence history. So he started to try and kind of benefit humanity. And as we kind of know, because it's in our timeline, that might not necessarily have always worked. But he was always trying new things and trying to influence the right path for humanity. There is other theories regarding how the Emperor was created. There was theories suggesting that he was just a normal mortal man who tricked the Chaos Gods, found a way to trick the Chaos Gods into... giving him the power, and then in return he didn't sort of...
Do we know the story? Is there a more fleshed out story of what the trick was?
Or? Unfortunately not. Unfortunately there's not much really suggested about it. It's just kind of this kind of hint of a theory. It's suggested that he did it with his brother. He tricked the Chaos Gods with his brother, but they were able to get his brother and sort of secure his soul for the Chaos Gods. He managed to survive this sort of trial, whatever it was they laid out. But generally, the canon of 40K seems to lie within the kind of story of the shamans. Mm-hmm. And one of the reasons that it's a more reliable backstory is the fact that later on in the 41st millennium, we have these other kind of organizations, orders, who are looking to reunite the lost children of the Emperor. Obviously, the Emperor lived for many, many millennia. He had children, we're guessing. So what happened then is that his bloodline lives on through other... other people. His bloodline has been continued
on. So he had his own Mary Magdalene's then, yeah?
Yeah.
For the signs of it. Okay.
Yeah.
He just needs a Dan Brown now to connect all the dots. So
essentially, yeah. So there's then these kind of Dan Brown characters traveling throughout the 41st millennium, looking to unite all of his children, who are called the Sensei, trying to unite them all together, and basically they want to re-perform the mass suicide.
With his children?
With his children. To hopefully then ending the life of the Emperor and reunite, you know, kind of reincarnating him again in another body. Although the downside to that would be the fact that the Emperor would have to die as he is. His soul would be ripped from where it currently is and placed in a new body. So there would be a lot of turmoil, a real end time, you know, where humanity was scattered again.
And there are also thoughts that the Eldar might have something to do with all of this as well. Because, like, you'd mentioned even there among the shamans that they'd been sensing the possible return or the creation of Slaanesh. Mm-hmm. So there must be an Eldar element to this somewhere.
Isn't there always? The Eldar have their fingers in everything, you know. They never let anything lie. So there is a link that the Star Child, who we see as the Emperor, is actually the reincarnation of an Eldar god called Yenid. I think that's how it's pronounced. I've only ever seen it written down, I'm afraid. So,
the god of dedication. Dedication's all you need. You get it?
I totally get it. Yeah,
you get it?
Yeah.
I wonder how many of you outside of the UK who are under 30 would even understand that. But well, anyway. So, wait. Let me take you back a bit. Mm-hmm. Star Child?
Yeah, so
who's
this,
a star? What's Star Child?
So the Star Child is the Eldar for a long time believed they could, again, like the shamans, they could sense this kind of disaster happening, or a few of their number could sense this disaster happening, and they believed that the being that could fight the Chaos Gods and fight off particularly this new threat, which we later find out is Slaanesh. An Eldar god who had kind of disappeared. So they figured that reincarnating him within the body of a Star Child, what they thought was going to be an Eldar, panned out to be hinted at that it was the Emperor that was planted, and he was this child, you know. There's a tablet. I can't remember the name of the book, but there's a tablet, an ancient Eldar tablet that's found in one of the Eldar worlds, and basically it depicts in Eldar hieroglyphics this story of the Star Child being implanted, and it shows the scene of ritual suicide and
So the stories marry up.
Sort of, yeah. They sort of match on this tablet. Anyway, we don't know what it reflects, but it's hinted at that you need is kind of part of this whole structure as well.
And you need is an Eldar god. Mm-hmm. Who was he before all of this? What role did you need play?
He was kind of a dark. He was quite a dark god. He was god of death. Uh-huh. We don't know too much about him, but we know that he's a god of death, but he was also a very, very powerful god, and a god that they knew could rival the powers of chaos. So whenever we see, for example, now the Emperor, although in the 41st millennium he's kind of in the golden throne and like just a cadaver, basically, his soul and his life force is an equal match for all of the chaos gods within the Imperium. The other suggestion is that the Emperor was essentially created to be one of the Chaos Gods, the God of Order. I think we touched on that briefly in the early part of the Chaos videos. But there's a hint that he could be this God of Chaos.
We'll be touching on the Eldar, I'm sure, at some point in the future. But The Eldar strike me as the dudes who know what's going on, most likely, but just aren't telling. Is that a fair enough assumption?
I think that's a fair enough assumption. The Eldar are obviously only in it for the Eldar. They only kind of enact plans to ensure the survival of the Eldar race, generally. Sometimes when that matches what humanity need, they kind of work alongside for as long as they need to. But ultimately, they are kind of, in the same way as the Imperium, they are selfish. They just want the survival of the Eldar race. which is understandable.
Yeah.
It's not a particularly noble quest, but essentially that's what happens. So what you find then is that the Eldar actually end up sometimes meddling with plans that they probably shouldn't. Mm-hmm. We see that throughout the kind of Horus Heresy. We'll talk about that a little bit later on, or maybe in one of the later videos. Mm-hmm. But generally they meddle in plans that they probably shouldn't be meddling with, but it's because they've seen the future. They've got this kind of ability to define the future, but it's always their means end up, because they're kind of just doing it for selfish reasons, sometimes they mess with the wrong bit mm-hmm. of the future, and things go awry. So...
Right, let me get this straight then, okay? So
maybe I've gone off on a bit of a tangent there.
No, because I'm looking at this and going, these stories, there seems to be a like connections between all of these. So original are, I don't know, the mythology of the Emperor mm-hmm. is that, you know, that these shamans committed this act of this ritual, and then he was created and he wandered the planet. Mm-hmm. At the same time, you know, the Eldar kind of believe that Yunid was he destroyed and brought back, or
that's quite vague. We don't know exactly what happened.
Were the timelines, like, for example, right? The shaman mm-hmm. sensed that Slaanesh or something mm-hmm. like that, we believe, was about to take place. Mm-hmm. Do we know roughly on the timeline when the Eldar, when Slaanesh, when yeah. the old, or the Eldar were the old ones before that, or what were they?
There seems to be some conflict. The old ones going way back to the old
All
ones.
All right, so forget about the old ones. That's me getting mixed up, right?
We'll have to look at the old ones. I think we'll have to do a video about them.
So the Eldar were a one kind of a unified kind of a thing, mm-hmm. and then Slaanesh tore a hole mm-hmm. in the galaxy. But when did that happen, roughly on the timeline? You know, is that something that happened closer to 8,000 BC or
there's kind of this is something that in 40k canon never really matches up. The timelines are a little bit askew. There seems to be kind of deviations throughout the years in the fluff. It seems to be whatever kind of makes sense at the time. They just sort of throw it in.
Which is fair enough, because although I'm treating this like total history at the moment, it is a story after all. Yeah. But I just love immersing and bathing myself in it. Yeah. You know,
so. And that's it. It's a story that's been around for, what, 30-odd years now? So it's a story that has had so many hands in it. And I quite like that as well, because I think it sort of makes sense. If you were a learned scholar in the Imperium, well, you might have a different idea about what the timeline is to an Eldar Farseer. You know, the Farseer...
The best stories are the ones that have the flaws and have little inconsistencies and stuff like that. If it was totally perfect, it wouldn't be interesting.
Exactly.
So it's... But part of the big interest to me is the inconsistencies and things like that, some of which may well be deliberate. Mm-hmm. By the writers and by the team mm-hmm. behind it all, but others may be just beautiful accidents. Mm-hmm. But anyway, when did it happen? When do we reckon the Slaanesh thing happened?
So, the most reliable sort of bit of information seems to come around the time of the 25th millennium in Imperial time. Mm-hmm. So, a good 5 years before. The likes of the Great Crusade and the Horus Heresy, 5,000 years before the Great Crusade and the Heresy. And what happens is the Emperor at this time is still hidden. He's still kind of floating around, kind of changing history and trying to help humanity as various different people. So he's kind of hidden his identity. It's then that he realizes that Slaanesh has kind of erupted, and he must therefore... sort of reveal himself. Mm-hmm. And he does this basically at this time to unify Earth. Mm-hmm. Terra is going through the in fact, the whole galaxy is going through the worst warp storms that it's seen. It's going through kind of, you know, terrible periods of planets being possessed and all sorts of weird and wonderful things happening. And we think this is all caused by the birth of Sunesh, this crazy kind of time. You know, we think it's all kind of inspired by the creation of, remember, the Eye of Terror?
Yeah.
Which was the hole ripped in real space by the birthing pains of Sunesh. So we think that all kind of started this massive kind of rift between real space and the Immaterium during the Age of Strife, what was known as the Age of Strife.
So these shamans possibly sensed that this was happening.
Mm-hmm.
They may well have known that the entity that they would create via that ritual would need thousands of years to prepare for what he was about to undertake.
Mm-hmm.
Hence why they did it when they did it. Meanwhile, the Eldar, they believe that Yenid in some way was involved in this, and then this is the Star Child. So did they enact a ritual to try and create the Star Child? Is that...
No, they very much just sort of let it happen. I think there was a large...
So they thought it was for them.
Yeah.
But if it is the same thing, then it was for humanity. Now, how would that make the Eldar feel about humanity?
Well, this is the thing. That's why a lot of the sort of Eldar don't believe in this kind of, in this theory. However, what you find is that the ones that do try and sort of help it along, they don't necessarily believe that it is man, you know, that the Emperor is man, but they believe that kind of it's part of what will restore order to the to the galaxy. The Eldar aren't necessarily against man. They just don't like what they're kind of seeing in the sort of after the Horus Heresy.
So there we we have his origin. Well, what the underlying mythos of how he may have been created. Mm-hmm. And bear in mind, remember, as always, guys, get into the comments. If you have updated information or if you have anything different, conflicting or supporting what we're talking about here, get it in the comments, because the comments are fascinating threads on all of this.
Definitely. I mean, this is the thing. We've seen it in a lot of the Chaos God videos as well.
Much additional info came flooding out.
And there's so many things that are kind of do conflict and change and are adapted, and there's only so much that you can kind of get a control of, get a handle of. And that was great to read some of those comments. I learned some
so
really
he's been
things.
Created. He's wandered through life. Is there anything from the time he was hidden, any kind of major milestones of things that they that say he may have been involved in when he was hidden or anything like that?
Well, one of the things that's hinted at is his influence of religion during this time. Obviously, throughout the span of humanity, a lot of kind of the humans have always tried to make sense of their surroundings, whether it was kind of believing in sun gods or dancing for, you know, kind of the rain to be created and, you know, all of that stuff that we have throughout our history. There was always this kind of need to believe in something. So what the Emperor does is he tries to use this to his advantage to protect humanity against the Chaos Gods. He influences different religions. There's no religions that are directly kind of hinted at, but obviously it would be, I would imagine, just the major religions that we have. And he tries to create this kind of good and evil within those religions, so that the people follow the good for the rewards and stay away from the bad, which is the Chaos Gods. He doesn't want the Chaos Gods to gain power, and he tries to protect humanity by influencing their belief. What happens, or what he ends up discovering, is that that's not necessary. That's fine for protecting humanity to a point, but that human nature always kind of gravitates, in the end, towards greed and those things that the Chaos Gods kind of thrive upon. And remember, the Chaos Gods, as we looked at, aren't necessarily good or bad. they just kind of are the epitome of what they kind of what they stand for. Mm-hmm. You know, Tzeentch is all about constant change and hope. So
all of that period then of influencing the religions to try and steer humanity away from chaos, mm-hmm. and then ultimately discovered that really the only way to avoid it was by no religion at all. You know, it was by, you know, the non-belief in chaos was the only thing that could potentially protect you from chaos.
Yeah.
So he tinkered with all of humanity's religions and then tried to create the ultimate religion of all, atheism. Yeah,
yeah. All right, okay. Essentially, what's known as the imperial truth, the belief in science, uh-huh. and reason and logic. You know, take from that what you will.
So, I want to talk then about before we close, to try and set us up for the next video where we talk about the timeline. Mm. I want to talk about his emergence. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we've covered, you know, the how we think he was created, what he did in the shadows. How did he emerge? What's the emergence story when he made himself known?
So during this incredibly dark time for humanity, there was very little he could do. With the warp storms, there was no way off planet. Terra itself had kind of dissolved into these kind of warring factions, these techno-barbarians, as they were known. And what the Emperor decided was basically that he had to unite, first of all, Terra, and then expand when he could to capture the rest of, to reunite the rest of humanity. And liberate those worlds that have been cut off for so long. What he did was he had a secret base in the Himalayas, like some kind of.
Was it shaped like an egg? Was he born from an egg on a mountain top?
he was like some sort of awesome Bond villain.
Bunker. Right, so he's born from an egg on a mountain top. Yeah. Really, does he have a secret bond?
He does have a secret kind of lair within the Himalayas.
Is the main palace? Is the Emperor's palace not in the Himalayas or something like that? Is it not in the mountains.
It sounds like, yeah, I'll double check that for the next video.
But strikes me that the actual palace, maybe that is where the palace then was built, possibly. Tell us in the comments. So he's in the Himalayas, mm-hmm. Eating yaks. Yeah. And he's got barbarians. Now, we're calling them barbarians, but these are our descendants some thousands of years from now. So what was he calling us other than awesome? Well, you know,
So remember, humanity had once again kind of collapsed in on itself. So these sort of techno-barbarians, so they obviously must have had wonderful technology from just before the Age of Strife, from this kind of before all.
Sorry, my mind is, you've blown me into techno-Viking here. I can't get techno-Viking out of my head now, so okay, yeah.
he unified them and he gathered them who he could to him, and created the first Geno warriors. So this was kind of very early on, a precursor to the Space Marines. Mm-hmm. He created the Geno warriors, and at the same time, I'll pull up a picture here. He created the Thunder warriors. Mm-hmm. Now, this is actually done up in the scheme of an Ultramarine, but the armor itself was very much of the early sort of Thunder warriors. This kind of very very early mark. And these guys were.
So is this even Mark One power armor?
Yeah. This is like the earliest of the power armor. As you can see, there's no kind of faceplate.
Yeah.
So this actually wouldn't have been suitable for, kind of space.
Yeah. Right enough. They could only have fought in atmosphere then.
Now
yeah.
This is, like I say, this is an image that I found online, and it's representative of the. Of the early Thunder Warriors, although there were
no Ultramarines.
But
this is the kind of gear that they would have had. Mm-hmm.
So the Geno Warriors and these guys, basically, they were used to unite Earth, unite Terra. And then what happened was, at the same time, the Emperor was still experimenting with kind of gene seed and things like that there, and he eventually created the Primarchs. Mm-hmm. Chaos then kind of found a way to scatter the Primarchs across the Imperium, sending them to within their kind of birthing capsules all across the Imperium, all across, you know, kind of the galaxy. Mm-hmm. And over the years then, of course it wasn't the Imperium at that point, but it was...
This we'll be discussing in the next one in terms of the Great Crusade and stuff like that. So, his first goal of everything was to unite the clans of Terra. Mm-hmm. Then,
yeah, and then within that, kind of recapture the likes of or join up with Mars, mm-hmm. And then kind of expand and try and.
Well, look, we'll be discussing this probably in more detail later. But on Mars. Mm-hmm. There was already a colony on mm-hmm. Mars. Mm-hmm. Who were they?
They were already kind of the Mechanicus, a very early form of the Mechanicus. Interestingly, they had had sort of large wars with sort of early sort of psykers and early sort of priests almost, kind mm-hmm. of sort of more sorcerers than psykers, if that kind of makes sense as a mm-hmm. difference. You know, they'd essentially fought many years against these kind of psyker priests, mm-hmm. And then sort of claimed Mars for the Mechanicus. Mm-hmm. And then that's when we'd seen the sort of development of STC technology and all that kind of stuff. That's way before the Emperor revealed himself.
Oh, so STCs and all mm-hmm. were already?
Yeah.
Which we will find out about in the next video. AJ, thank you very much for that. Guys, post below the origin story of the Emperor. What do you know? What have you heard? What do you suspect? Mm-hmm. I suspect that if we could ever get access to a black library, we'd probably find it all in there. Yeah. Methinks that the Eldar had a lot more to do with everything that's happening in the galaxy than perhaps they're letting on. Right, stay tuned, guys. We'll be back next week, and we're going to go through that the kind of the timeline of the Emperor from the point of his emergence mm-hmm. to the point of the heresy to understand what was going on there. And yeah, we'll see you then. Take care. Hey, I hope you enjoyed that episode. Right, so we have a few links up to help you out. Check out the playlist. We also have a subscribe option, and remember, if you subscribe, to click the bell to ding our dong. Finally, if you're into binge watching and you want a whole lot more 40k charted, come on over to beastofwar.com, join Backstage, and you get early access to all of the seasons.